Here you go. Using those very well adapted hands to pluck the berries from the guari trees, or even inspecting some of them. Better make sure that you get the ripest ones. Oh, there's a good patch. Sudden emergence. There's something so recognizable in their expressions. And Deborah, who is our armchair traveler, has said this is the first time that she's ever had a good view of baboons on our live drive, and it's absolutely the best sighting of baboons I've had since I started working in this area. It's bizarre. I never thought I'd say that. I certainly never thought I'd respond to a baboon sighting called in on the radio. But in the last year that I've been working here, baboons have been exceptionally scarce. We hardly ever get to see them. Apparently, the regular viewers, or the sort of the more long-term viewers of Safari Live, have told me that they used to see a troop of baboons that they nicknamed the Gowrie Gang on a fairly regular basis. But that is no more. That's largely due to the drought, most of them moving to the riverine areas where there's more fruit trees, better food options, and better foliage cover. There's that typical baboon swagger. Back legs falling outside of the front legs. There's still more. I'm really hoping that we'll get to be able to show you a large male baboon. Because a large baboon, large male, is an incredibly impressive specimen. Their canine teeth are larger than those of a leopard. And even a leopard will think twice about taking on a baboon troop that is guarded by a big adult male. There's still one. Hopefully she's going to move out into the open. Baboons have a really interesting social structure. It's called oligarchy. An oligarchy is basically a group of dominant males, sort of two or three very, very large males that will guard the group and protect them. And they do take on a very fatherly role, even to offspring that are not their own. I've heard of baboons rushing back to protect babies that have been caught by leopards, and, well, leopards are generally the only animal, or even trying to rescue them from the clutches of a crocodile. I saw the most incredible documentary on a male baboon that tried to go back and save a youngster that had been caught by a crocodile, which is an incredible sign of bravery. Now, there are lots of little mongoose dashing about, little dwarf mongoose. There's a slender. Oh, it's a slender. Oh, wow. We've got two rare animal sightings in one. We hardly ever get to see a slender mongoose, and it's only because we're this far away that we are. You need to see even now, looking back at us. So how did I know that was a slender? Much, much longer tail. They've got a tail that extends about three times the length of a dwarf mongoose tail, and it is tipped with black. I'm going to try sneaking forward. Hopefully they'll let me. Because there's still some playing about in the guari bushes off to our right. And as I said, I'm really keen to get to show you a large male baboon. It's a pity the light isn't great for looking for tracks. Otherwise, I would be able to show you some really clear baboon tracks in this area. Don't go. There's a biggish male. Not quite full-sized yet, though. They've obviously found something wonderful underneath the guari bushes there. Plucking away industriously at the berries. There's a little one at the back. Oh, this is so exciting. Now, in most other places that I have worked, baboons are actually quite a stressful animal to have around. They get used to people very quickly, and they very, very often raid the various kitchens or dustbins or whatever they happen to have access to. And of course, there's the famous story about, I think it was it the Singita or the Londolozi glass doors that the baboons kept working out how to break open and cost the lodge somewhere in the region of a good 50,000 rand in repairs. They can be very bold, very clever. I remember being in a place called Sun City, and I will finish that story in a moment, sorry. Let's send you back across to Steph, who's doing more animal stalking, and see if the wildebeest have spotted him yet.
Well, contrary to what I've actually been trying to do, is sneak up onto these wildebeest, we've actually just walked into the open, and it's had the most amazing effect. Yes, we are about the same distance away, but they've stopped and are giving us warning calls, and I think the only reason I can have for behind it is the fact that they absolutely know that they can get away from us with the least amount of ease. I'm sure they're looking at Jandre's cars, wondering if he can do the 0 to 100 sprint in 3 seconds. Probably isn't too far from the truth, but the reality is that these are plains animals that are geared specifically to running long distances very fast. And I think us standing in the open has literally just given them the reassurance that we can't catch them no matter what. There's no more cover to hide behind. They're slowly moving away from us at the moment. As you cut to us, you would have heard them giving a few alarm calls, or you would have seen them blowing at us and looking at us directly. And that was just them telling us, hey, we've seen you and we're not scared of you. It's actually quite amazing. You learn something new about animal behavior every day. And on that note, we're just going to send you back to Jamie and see what else we can find.
I believe we are still with our baboon troop. This is so exciting. I'm so glad I took the chance of coming here, because Brent called them in and I sort of had to toss up whether or not they would still be here when I got here. Luckily for us, they are. Oh, I was going to tell you the story about a place called Sun City, which was started by Saul Kersner back in very dark days of history in South African politics, but a place where, before gambling was made legal, where people could go to gamble, but it's now become a holiday resort. And I went there once as a small child, and I remember sitting on the deck chair next to the pool watching a woman drink a pink milkshake. And this baboon came by so fast, snatched the pink milkshake cup out of her hand, sat down in the pool lounger next to her, and proceeded to drink her milkshake and pour half of it down its front. So she was left watching this baboon, covered in bright pink, next to her, and I can't quite fully convey the humor of that particular sighting, but it was truly incredible. Dave, let's have a look if we can. We move. Oh, here comes big boy. Hello. Still not the biggest male I've ever seen, but large enough. I was going to say, we've got some on our left here as well. This is so wonderful. Peekaboo. Yes, we see you. And Joey, you wanted to know if there's a chance that we could be seeing this troop more regularly now that they've moved, or if they are moving into this area. I've just been thinking the exact same thing myself, because I'm sure many of you have noticed, and Joey, I'm sure you're amongst the viewers that have, that we've been seeing more and more signs of baboons, not necessarily baboons themselves, but tracks and evidence that they've been around, mostly around Treehouse Dam. We've had the most regular sightings. Can you actually see that one that's sitting there, David? Would I have to go forward for you to be able to see it? Sitting just to the left of that main gwari bush patch. It's okay. It's all right. Don't panic, baboon. Just stick around. So, Joey, it would be interesting. We've certainly seen more of them. The drought could well push them back into this area, since there is water here. and therefore a good place to be. They might just be passing through because it's a nice quarry bush patch, but I'm hoping that they might decide to move in for a little while and come and join us. I mentioned that they are something of troublemakers in certain areas, but birds are free. You were wondering if they've ever come into our camp. The answer is no, not while I've been around. I'm sure it did used to occur with the Gowrie gang on a regular basis. But from our side, since I've started working at Wild Earth, no. The only primate, actually the only two primates we've had in camp are the monkeys on a pretty much daily basis, when they decide to come through and see if they can pick up on any rusks left on the table for breakfast or anything like that. Usually waking up whoever happens to be having a lion on their morning off by pounding their way across the tin roof. And then the bush baby as well that fell out of the tree one day and landed at the base of the hut that Connor lives in. But no baboons. And it's not really something we want to encourage. We're exceptionally careful with the amount of waste that we use and making sure that we keep the dustbins well protected and closed off and away from prying little hands or jaws or whatever else happens to decide to wander in, like the hyenas, for example. And obviously we don't want to encourage them becoming more familiar with human habitation, because that in turn becomes a risk to the baboon's life. I was speaking a little bit, I know we don't have the best view, but I was chatting earlier about those calluses underneath a baboon's tail around the genital area. So they are called ischial callusites, and they can be very, very brightly coloured. What they serve to do, because primates of course do have exceptionally good colour vision, what they do serve to do is to sort of let every baboon in the area know what the reproductive status is of that particular baboon. So they become much more swollen. Oh, it's okay, calm down. Oh, I'm being watched with serious concern here. James Richards, you were wondering what the average size of a baboon troop is, and they can be absolutely enormous. You can get them up to about 40, 50 individuals. Again, it's area dependent, and it's dependent on the amount of food, the amount of sort of the suitability of the territory, and all kinds of factors like that. But if we take the area that we're in now, you're probably looking at an average of between 20 to 30 individuals. Maybe even less in this particular area, just because it's not quite the best territory for a baboon troop. And I must say, I've missed their barking and screaming. They've got such a wide range of vocalizations. That deep, booming bark. Bow! That I've always come to associate, or I have come to associate with the African bushveld. So it's lovely to see them, spend a bit of time with them. And I have a confession to make. And you'll have to keep this a secret, because I was quite a tomboy as a little girl, believe it or not. I'm sure that comes as a tremendous surprise to all involved. But there was one animal, there were two animals that I was particularly scared of. One was monkeys and one was baboons, and that was because in my childhood years I had encounters with both of them. And when you're a little girl, a baboon is a very big thing, especially when there are lots of them. My cousin was bitten by one when she decided that a little baby baboon that was sitting on the ground had been abandoned by its mother. And we were very, very young at the time, but we didn't know any better, and she decided that she was going to go and give it a good cuddle. And that unfortunately ended very badly for her, and ended with a series of rabies shots and tetanus injections. She's absolutely fine, but it did instill something of a healthy respect for baboons. I said that the males can be exceptionally large and quite scary. I once took out the rubbish in an area that we were staying in the Drakensberg, which, by the way, if you ever happen to come and visit South Africa, I would highly, highly recommend coming to or going and paying a visit to parts of the Drakensberg. I was taking out the rubbish to the tip, and a large male baboon came, knocked me over, and took it out of my hands. So as a young girl, I definitely had a healthy respect for baboons. I've had them jump in through my car window before, jump over my lap, take a sandwich out of my hand, and jump out the other side. And in Cape Town, there are some famous troops that have been known for actually breaking and entering people's flats and houses and raiding kitchens. They're just very intelligent. They're very interesting animals. Now there's some... We are on the main road, and poor old Jim Reeves has been trying to get past us for the last half an hour or so since we arrived at the sighting. What I'm going to do is I'm going to try and pull over. Hopefully our baboons... Oh, discipline. Hold on. A little bit of internal dispute there. That's probably a male disciplining a younger, a juvenile of some description, whether it be male or female. As I said, they take a very strong parental role. That extends to discipline as well. We're just going to shift ever so slightly out of the way. And while we do, I'm going to send you back across to Steph, who has managed to track down and stalk a butterfly.
What a fortuitous series of events has just happened over the last 2 or 3 minutes. We got chased out of where we were by a buffalo, came running down the bank where we're standing at the moment, and chased us onto where we are now. We needed to get into a bit of a safer place. And just as we got there and started to realize where we were, we found a resting citrus swallowtail. This is the largest butterfly that we find in this area. It's a butterfly. And because it's quite chilly this morning and overcast, there's something running behind us. I think it's zebra or wildebeest though. But anyway, today's got us all spooked. Because it's cold today, this butterfly hasn't really got going yet. And it's giving us the most... There's another buffalo there. Sorry, we're being ambushed here by almost everything. I want to show you this buffalo. Come through here, Jandre. I actually just want to make sure that we're not going to get ambushed again. I just want to climb up onto this termite mound. Seems like 2 or 3 buffalo have started to come into this area for some reason. There's just one I can see. He's probably no more than 10 or so meters from us. He's probably going to come out onto this game path here. We're relatively safe where we are on top of this termite. But this has also allowed me some height. So while we look for this buffalo, Jamie's baboons are running away, so before they run away and disappear, you're going to go back to her.
You've arrived just at the right time because our baboon troop is on the move. Racing across the road. We've just had about 20 of them run in front of us, so this is a very, very large troop. Here comes a straggler. Come on, better catch up, buddy. I think this one does actually have... Oh, no. The one that you saw across first did have a baby hanging underneath her belly. That one looks pregnant to me. Exceptionally so. Very caring, very nurturing mothers, just like all primates, particularly the New World monkeys. Let's try and reposition. That was the last of them, and I'm hoping we can still get a view because they actually haven't gone too far. They've just moved out of the open. I'm hoping sound of the year. Yes. Wandering about behind that knobthorn, a fallen tree. This is extraordinary. My first proper baboon sighting since I started working here. Dave, this must be your first one as well.
Yeah, sure is.
This is wonderful. This is the most time we've got to spend with baboons in a very, very long time. I wonder where they came from. Which particular area? Of course, you can't really fence a baboon or a primate. They don't really bother too much about such barriers. They can easily hop over any fence. So they do stick around. Those dexterous tails. Here we go. Hitsman, you're on the same wavelength I am. You were wondering about the baboon's tails and if they can use it to grip or climb to help them. Not quite as dexterous as a monkey's tail, but nevertheless, yes, they can use them. They don't quite curl and grip in the same way a monkey's tail can, but they can use them as a balancing tool, and occasionally they can anchor themselves with their tails. And you were on exactly the same line of thought that I was going down. I had a long and very bizarre discussion with Viam, as one does. Dave's chuckling away just because he knows. And we basically came to the conclusion that if it were normal, we would prefer to have tails than to not have tails. Tails like a monkey's tail. Just imagine all of the things that you could do with it. You could hold that extra cup of coffee with it as you open a door, or you could use it to help you climb. One of those bizarre thoughts and bizarre conversations that one has whilst watching animals. It seems as though Brent has joined the party, and we do, of course, have him to thank for the baboon sighting. Let's head across to him and his stripy donkeys.
So it started off as a beautiful, gorgeous morning. It's now come a bit grey and dreary. They're one of the nicest animals to look at in the grey and dreary conditions. Are the black and white stripes of a zebra. So it looks like two young stallions here that obviously are not quite old enough to defend a harem of their own, so they're hanging with the impalas. So unfortunately Sam is a bit under the weather, so I've jumped in to Sam's seat and will be with you till the end of the drive. And again on the sunset safari. You hear that, Vian?
Yes. It's not rotting.
Listening. There's some snorting impala trying to figure out whether they're just chasing other males or there might be something around. But just judging from the rest of the animals' reactions, the other impala and zebra here have barely lifted their heads, so it's probably just a male snorting at another male. Okay. Oh, what is VM spotted? Ooh, nice VM. A good test for the birders this morning. So, whoops. There we go. Look at the general size, shape and impression. Now, when he turns his head sideways, look very, very carefully. Oh, off he goes. There's a pair of them. There's another one still there at the beak. If you notice, there's some very, it almost looks like whiskers around the end of the beak. And it's a diagnostic of the family, as well as the white ring around the eye and the throat. There we go, off they go. So there's a nice little quiz to get going on this sunrise safari. It might be a bit grey, and so is that bird. But let's see who can figure out which bird that is. So if you can identify that particular bird, pop me an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Now let's go see what else is out and about. So I was out a bit earlier tracking, and we did find Tingana's tracks. Now I know a few of you might have seen one, the dam cam last night. Tingana, being a male leopard, marched right through the center of Djuma last night and went into torchwood. So unfortunately, he has absconded. And I just heard over the radio now that that cheetah we were all desperately searching for yesterday has been spotted. A very unrelaxed male cheetah. And it ran into Buffalo's Hook. And it was spotted by a taxon. Unfortunately, that's gone. So let's hope that something else is moving. I'm hoping this cool weather might prompt Karula to do a bit of a meander towards us. So we're going to head down towards the southern boundary and go have a look around there. This cold front just pulled in from nowhere. And it was beautiful, sunny this morning. And then I was driving west along the northern boundary and lovely light in front of me. And then as we turned the corner and looked behind, we just saw this wall of cloud creeping in. And the temperature's actually dropped. It's probably colder now than it was a bit earlier. So Jennifer was wondering, and as I was explaining about those leopard tracks, it's more than likely Tingana, dominant male, calling in this area and popping up on the Djuma dam cam as one of his favorite little spots to stop for a drink on his way through. And it was I'm pretty sure it was Tingana. I haven't seen any of the screenshots yet, but he's moved straight through to Torchwood on a route that he uses often. So I'm quite confident, I'm 98% sure it was Tingana. Oh, hello. Wildly beasts up ahead. It's amazing how quickly they grow. I mean, those two on the right, or actually the three on the right, there's an adult female off to the left there, but those are all this year's baby. Look how big they've got and how quickly. And another name for the blue wildebeest is also the brindled gnu. And you can see that sort of striping on the neck. And that's one of the things that leads to their name. So what that is actually just a little bit of longer hair around the neck area that gives that sort of stripy effect. And even more noticeable in the early morning as they're trying to puff it up to get a little bit of warmth and create that little insulative blanket. Fortunately for wildebeest, they're not as furry as the others, so it's not as easy for them to create that blanket. Now, I wonder where the rest of the herd are. They could be around off to the right, and they're the first moving out of the thickets onto the clearing this morning. Well, what have you spotted, Vim? More wildebeest. There we go. So there they are. And there's some zebras in there as well, it looks like. More zebras. Here on the zebras. Well, there. You just see some stripes through the... A little to the right. There we go. You can see it.
Not from my angle.
Not from your angle. Now let's move forward a skosh. Now, it's not uncommon to find wildebeest and zebra together. Now, wildebeest actually quite like hanging with zebra because they're bulk grazers and they keep the grass really short. And wildebeest are very specialist grazers and they only eat certain grass species and it has to be short. So they'll actually fussily feed between the different grasses. There we go. Here comes... And there's the rest of the herd, with the zebras just behind them. Yeah. So Hitzman is wondering, how big do wildebeest herds get? Now, with a lot of animals, it's rather area-specific rather than species-specific. The biggest group of wildebeest I've seen in the greater Kruger, it's probably around 60 or so on the basalt plains around Sitara. But as one knows, the blue wildebeest that take part in the great migration between Tanzania and Kenya, there's about 1.2 million in that group, so massive. Now, even within that group, there will be smaller nuclei sort of herds with a bull, but in this area, they don't really get too big. Sabi Sands, the biggest I've seen is around 30. Flycatcher, did we see a short while ago? But, well, let's leave the wildebeest to move out onto the open clearings of quarantine. And I did hear some elephants earlier, so I'm going to go and see if we can find those. Okay, so what's going to be out under the cloudy skies? I'm hoping for some ellies. And there was a herd around Gauri Cutline earlier, so we're going to go move into that area, see if we can find the elephants. Okay, so but before we do that, let's put the bird quiz to bed, so to speak. So Justin and James Richard say a dusky flycatcher. Oh, are you guys right? I wonder. So here we go. Let's just get the flycatchers out quickly. And doom, that's chagrins. Okay. And it should be the next page. Now, the reason it is an African dusky flycatcher, and you were correct. So I told you, we saw those little feathers there that almost look like whiskers, the white throat and the white around the eye. So well done, guys, the African dusky flycatcher. And we, other thing it lacked, it didn't have any white windows in the wings, so that rules out... where is he now? The ashy flycatcher. Also, ashies are a bit smaller. But they do also have that white eye ring, but the ashy is generally around drainage lines and places like that. African dusky we can find all over the place. Well, after flycatchers, it seems like Jamie is taking up the birding mantle, and she's got bird to show you.
Well, the temperature has dropped dramatically, and we're not the only ones who are feeling it. And this poor, dark, chanting goshawk, oh my word, at some point my speech patterns will normalize. A dark, chanting goshawk is sitting huddled very firmly on the top of this dead tree, using it as a useful vantage point. We may well have seen this individual goshawk before, that incredible sighting with Brent where it caught a snake right on in front of the camera. They are relatively territorial, so there's a good chance of seeing one in the same position, which is we're very close to where he had that sighting. Now, yesterday, you had that sighting with the honey badgers and with Sam, an extraordinarily rare occurrence. There's a very interesting connection between goshawks and honey badgers. Now, most of you will have heard the story of the honey guide, a type of bird that is actually capable of digesting beeswax. Now, the honey guide is famous for leading animals like honey badgers to beehives, and they basically use the honey badger as a way to break it open, and then they feast on whatever leftovers are left behind. and the fork-tailed drongo comes in for the attack. They are such brave little birds, fork-tailed drongos. Never miss a chance to bother a bird of prey. Now, is he going to go in again? And while we wait in eager anticipation to see what this fork-tailed drongo is going to decide to do, I was going to say that goshawks also have a very similar relationship with honey badgers. Not quite the same as the bird that's known as a honey guide, but the honey badger and the pale-chanting goshawk, which is a bird that we don't really get in this area, but it's very closely related to the dark-chanting goshawk, have a very close relationship. They'll often, you'll find them associating together. Because the honey badger is such a ferocious and successful little hunter, the goshawks often follow behind to pick up the scraps. But they can also lead honey badgers to potential prey. There's a little animal connection I bet not many of you had thought about or heard about before. What are you thinking, Drongo? Are you going to go in, or are you satisfied that you've established your dominance? For a tiny bird, the fork-tailed Drongo definitely does not lack any courage. And just while we're sitting here, it just goes to show the value of spending a little bit of time sitting nice and quietly in the bush, because we've got some interesting things happening, and we've got another animal association playing out right in front of us, and that is between the yellow-billed hornbill, that is currently pecking away at whatever scraps they can find in the road. And then if we look carefully, every now and again you'll see the flash of movement, that is a dwarf mongoose. Now there's another two species with a very ooh, it's an upset elephant around quarantine. So another animal that has a very close bond. Again, the hornbill's taking advantage of the dwarf mongoose's prowess at hunting, picking up any scraps that they may leave behind. And in return, they provide an extra set of eyes that is capable of being at a slightly higher level than that of a dwarf mongoose. And the relationship has reached the point to such an extent that an associating group of hornbills and mongoose, if the mongoose are not up yet, the hornbills have been recorded to go to the entrance of the burrow where they saw the mongoose going to sleep and calling, making a racket until the mongoose wake up. And if the mongoose emerge and discover that their hornbill friends are not around to help keep them safe, then they show a great reluctance to leave their burrows until the hornbills have arrived. Another special little relationship that plays out in this area. See if we can't get a little bit closer now that those dwarf mongoose are starting to emerge. They've had a nice long lion this morning. Since it is really cold, it almost feels as though it's going to rain, which would be unusual but not totally unheard of in winter. Morning. Anybody home? I know somebody's home because I saw you. There is a head poking out on the right-hand side of that dead log. Believe it or not, right at the base. There you go. Hello. We've spotted you. Despite your best efforts. And we can tick two mongoose species off for this morning's drive. Playing peekaboo. And in winter, dwarf mongoose are very reluctant to leave the warmth and relative safety of their termite mound homes. It's just a bit cold for them. And it's nice and warm in the termite mounds. Here we go. Getting a little bit braver. Out you come. I don't know where the rest of them are. This is obviously the early riser. The early mongoose catches the scorpion. Or something to that effect. And since it's decided to disappear, let's go from one very tiny animal to one exceptionally large one.
So those ellies we could hear were right where we thought they would be. It seems like quite a big breeding herd spread through the bush. Yum, yum bush willow. So it is wonderful at the moment that we hear elephants throughout the night, and it is just one of the best sounds in the world to go to sleep to. Breaking of branches, rumble of communication. That's definitely one of the quintessential African bush sounds, that low. Hopefully they're going to move through into a bit more open an area. So they are slowly moving in the direction of the Djuma waterhole, probably about 600 meters from there at the moment. Herd is quite spread out. We can hear them all around us. At the moment, we've only got a really good visual of these two. We can see a very tiny bit. There we go. Now she's gonna move. Here's the little one. And I was trying to show you Mom's tusk. Let's try maybe go backwards rather than forwards. Got a hole there, Vim. So if we look at her left tusk, oh, there's a little one in front as well. Hey, mister, we'll look at your mom's tusks after we finish. There it is, there's that rumble. Wow. So incredible. What are you up to, little horror? That's incredible. A baby elephant at birth is still 100 kilograms. I mean, that's massive. So over 200 pounds at birth. Not something you can sort of pick up and take home with you. I'm having a little trouble with my comms, but let's jump across to Jamie while we try to fix it.
Look at this incredible moth that Dave has just found. Oh, don't go just yet. I will let you go in a moment. It's incredibly bright pink. Wow. I have absolutely no idea what this is, and I have certainly never encountered one. But it is so beautiful. with the most incredible bright pink colour. It's now frantically flapping its wings. Oh, there it goes. That was so beautiful. I don't know if you could see, but its wings were actually transparent. It had transparent eyes on the outer edges of its wings, and then that incredibly vibrant neon pink colour. Now, if any of you have any idea what that particular moth species is, I sort of initially thought of one of the burnet families. We've seen the firegrid burnet moth. But is that part of the burnet family or not? I know some of you actually have a really sort of interesting fascination with moths in particular. That's how we identified many, many months ago the thin marbled lichen moth that we discovered on the vehicle. So if any of you have any idea what particular moth that was, please send that through on #SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. I think it's safe to say it's a diurnal moth. It's a daytime moth. It's out and about at this time. Most of the nocturnal moths are sleeping. So while you ponder that, I'm going to send you back to Brent.
Look at that. VM spotted a spider web just in front of the Ellie there. We're trying to see it. We can't see the spider in the web. It's still incredible patterns upon patterns. And there, look at that. Oh. So, if you've ever seen sort of a dry lake or a dry pan, that crisscrossed baked mud, elephant skin sort of always gives me that impression of a sort of a dry lake. Incredibly thick and tough. That skin is probably about 5 centimeters, 6 centimeters thick. Try and move back a little bit. Let's see if I can get a better view. How's that, Ben? Looks like the little one's about to have a drink. Well, it is having a drink, just unfortunately on the wrong side of Mom. So I heard you saw an incredible moth with Jamie in a pinkish color. Now, I'm just going to call Jamie on the radio because I think I might know what it is. Jamie. Jamie, if you've got the insect book there, have a look for, I think it's the Shea defoliator, or the Latin is Cirina, C-I-R-I-A. Oh, and the Ellie's are going off into the thickets, so we're going to chance our luck and head down Twin Dams. And fingers crossed, Queen Karula has decided during this cool morning to move back onto Djuma. Now, of course, I am the eternal optimist. I always believe we're going to find a cat, even if there's no sign of a cat. So it's always worth having a second look. Hi, Joey from Australia. Joey is your nickname because you look like a baby kangaroo, or is it Joseph? Only joking. Joey would like to know whether a kudu or nyala or impala would alarm call one of the smaller cats like serval or caracal. And they would. And sometimes I have seen impala get very confused and alarm at a serval thinking it's possibly a leopard. So it does happen. Especially if the cat's moving through some slightly thicker bush and they just sort of catch glimpses of it. Oh, very chilly. Well, we have a vast, vast amount of different fauna and flora. And Dylan and I was asking specifically about the flora and is asking whether we get any fir trees or conifers in South Africa. Not indigenous like they are in the States, but there are actually pine trees and fir trees that are growing commercially for wood. And there is one or two indigenous conifers, if I remember correctly, in the Eastern Cape Mountains. They don't look the same as the fir trees, but they are conifers. And then if you head further north in Africa, oh, is it Nelson? It's Nelson. I thought he was dead. I'm keeping his blind eye, he's a bit jumpy. The impala with one eye, one horn, and one ambition to avoid Karula. And he seems to be doing it quite well. I really thought he'd been eaten by now. Oh, off you go, Nelson. Be careful. Sorry about that. Didn't I go very excited? I haven't seen Nelson in a few months.
Unless that's a new Nelson.
Unless there's a new Nelson with one eye, one horn, but it's unlikely. But as I said, if we move further into North Africa, specifically the northern highlands of Ethiopia, there are indigenous cyprids. I think they're called the mountain cypress, which is a conifer. Oh, hello. More elephants. Young Ellie Bull. Hello, mister. You can see he's thinking about giving us a head shake. I'm going to wait till we go past him. Very normal elephant bull behavior. No, he's not. He's decided we're not worth shaking his head at. He's probably trailing that breeding herd we've just seen, but staying on the peripheries. And there you can see into his ear. It looks like he's been sprayed a bit of mud in there at some point. Still a bit damp. And there you can see that white around the corner of the eyes, which is quite common at this time of the year. And it's all the dust buildup and oh, look at that. You can see right in there. And that's just the eye expelling the dust. Apparently, Dangerous Dave and Jamie were sneezing quite heavily earlier from the dust. Oh, we just got a glimpse of his pink tongue in there. Look at that. Not every day you get to see an elephant's tongue. Hey, mister. He's eating a monkey orange tree, which is something they don't normally eat too often unless there's very little else around. So we will see elephants eating quite a few different species that wouldn't be their first choice normally due to the drought. Just try to reverse a little bit. Always remember, let your engine run for a second before moving. How's that, Vim? Better? Oh. So, Dave in Indiana is wondering, do we have yellowwood trees in South Africa? We do, Dave. It's one of our protected species. It used to grow quite extensively in the Mist Belt region of South Africa. Now, the Mist Belt is an area between the high veld and the low veld, the edge of the middle veld. And it has obviously got a higher rainfall than everywhere else, and you get these incredible forests. And a lot of those forests get their moisture from the mist, hence the name, the Mist Belt. And yellowwoods are common there. The early European settlers cut down most of the yellowwoods. They're incredibly, incredibly beautiful and durable wood. Ooh, and let's look at those toenails. Look at that. Isn't it incredible having this new super zoom? You get to see stuff and you really, really only normally see when an animal's sedated. Massive shock absorbers inside the elephant's foot. The sort of spongy cartilaginous area that acts as a shock absorber to carry that elephant's great weight. But sorry, Dave, back to your yellowwood question. And the early settlers used to use yellowwoods for beams in their houses, tables, chairs. So it's a protected species. You're not allowed to cut it down at all anymore. But it is absolutely this beautiful, beautiful wood. My parents have a massive yellowwood table that my dad got made out of beams saved from an old farmhouse in the Eastern Cape. So they used to be the roof beams, the support beams for the house, and we had a table made out of it, and it is an exquisite table. What are you eating in there? You just see his trunk sniffing around, trying to find the exact piece he wants, because it's a little thicker. There's a couple of different species of tree in there. I can't see exactly which tree he's going for, but I suspect it could be the spike thorn. I doubt it's the timberti. And he's done that, and off he goes. And he's about to head into a little river system. It's going to be very thick, so let's let him continue on his way. James Richard is wondering if I've ever seen an elephant root tree. James, I'm not exactly sure what you're referring to. Maybe if you send me the first part of the scientific name, it might give me a better idea. Common names are often not a good way to go by because the trees can be called different things in different areas. Pretty little bird, I'm trying to show you quickly. Where did he go? There he is. Oh. Got him there. Yeah. He keeps flitting away. And we're still surrounded by elephants. Us an inspection. I mean, we've been going for about a kilometer and a half now, and literally on both sides of the road there are just elephants the whole way through. Yeah, the little bird I'm trying to show you. I can't see him just yet. He disappeared into this little leadwood here. I think he's gone out the other side. Yeah, well, we continue to search for that little bird, which unfortunately has done a disappearing act. Let's go to Steph, who's got a little tiny insect.
Here's a brilliant example of flash coloration for you. I was just busy getting something out of my backpack and this little grasshopper jumped onto my shorts. Now you can see that there's red on the back of his legs. I'm not holding him very tight at all. He can move, but you can see the red on the back of his legs over there. That is what a predator would see as this grasshopper was jumping away from it, this brilliant flash of red. It would then land and it would immediately disappear into the undergrowth. I'm going to put him down. He's probably going to jump away. But there you go. Have a look at how camouflaged that guy has just turned into the sticks over there. Right where my finger is a grasshopper with those brilliant red legs. Flash coloration gives the predator a bit of a startle, boom, and then all of a sudden it disappears again and blends completely into the undergrowth there with these. Amazing, isn't it? These grasshoppers are really something phenomenal. I see right around it, we've got quite an interesting thing over here. We've got a young hairy caterpillar pod here. And a lot of these trees are quite common out here. Not often. Caterpillar is a genus in where it gets its name from. They are the hairy caterpillar pods. Quite nice, eh? This tree used widely amongst the local population over here as a little bit of an aphrodisiac remedy. Or not remedy, as an aphrodisiac. It's mixed into a drink, an elixir, for lack of a better word, that they then drink, and it's supposed to fortify you as a man. And then I picked some of this a little bit earlier. This is one of my favorite grasses. I've had it in my pocket for a while. This is turpentine grass. What this grass does is it has an oil in it, an essential oil, turpentine oil, and literally just doing that and placing that under the kindling of your fire catches a spark with a piece of flint unbelievably well. That turpentine oil that's in here is an incredibly flammable oil, and you'll use that as a bit of fire starting material when you're trying to make a fire out here. Being a hero and not bringing a box of matches or a lighter or some other modern marvel that we'd use in normal camping and outdoor wilderness trails, you can use this. But it has the most unbelievably nice smell. Oh, it's a little bit intense, I must be honest with you. I'm going to give it to Jandre to smell, because it's obviously I can put on a show, but you can't. I'm going to give you the camera over here. You're going to see Jandre's face.
I haven't done my makeup stuff.
Have a smell of that. Strong, eh? Chandra's not impressed with me for hijacking his camera. I suppose it'll be the same as him hijacking my rifle. Let's carry on going. We're in quite a botanically rich part of the reserve at the moment. As you can see, just from this very patch of bush that we got going on over here, we've actually got quite a lot of trees. We've got this one here is the common spikethorn. We then have a dead knobthorn that was pushed over by an elephant. Right here we've got a white berry bush, which is this one. And then here we have a round leaf teak, or round leaf bloodwood, is this one right here. And then this one right here is a guari, Euclea divinorum. So it's four or five different species and a porcupine bush. So four or five different species of trees that we have right over here. I mean, all in this little area. And that's because we're right on the edge of a drainage line. And on the edge of a drainage line is where the sandy soils start giving way to clay soils. Clay soils and are actually quite good at harboring trees. They relinquish their water quite hard. But trees have got the ability to then get that water out of that clay and dry up enough for you to get a good germination of trees, as you can see over here. Let's carry on going. See what we can get out of this patch of bush. I Aaron has asked me a nice question. With the lack of rain, are we likely to see more animals that we don't usually see? Aaron, I'm going to say yes to that. There is a herd of sable antelope that occurs along the eastern boundary of the Sabi Sands, here in the northern Sabi Sands, that we share between Manyeleti, basically the Manyeleti Game Reserve, the Kruger National Park, and the Sabi Sands. And with the Kruger National Park over the last couple of years having closed down all their watering points on their western boundary, on our eastern boundary, animals like sable are being drawn to water points inside the Sabi Sands. And although we saw one a couple of months ago, in actual fact, on the show, we managed to quickly get a fleeting glimpse of a sable. I predict that we're going to be seeing more and more sable as this drought progresses, and as the sable need to come closer and closer to water, or basically come to water closer and closer to the camps that we've got over here. So I predict sable, that's what I'm going to say, and probably an increase in cheetah and wild dog sightings as well. They also tend to do quite well in drier conditions. They're a little bit more drought hardy, at least, than what lion and leopard are. Hope that answered your question, Aaron. Ah, and while we thread our way through this forest over here, Jamie's got a mongoose that's quickly going to go there quickly before it runs away.
We have a slightly more awake group of dwarf mongoose, although there's still some late risers who are showing a little bit of reluctance to go wandering out and about. Most of the family, though, has started dashing off in their foraging directions. Remember, we were talking about the relationship with the dwarf mongoose and the hornbill? Well, there's another little bird that's joined in, and it is sitting on the branch just to the left of the group. I don't know if you can see the drongo there. Sort of there. There's a fork-tailed drongo, and if you watch it flapping about, you'll see every now and again it ducks down and searches for any scraps that the mongoose might have disturbed. Now, most of you are aware of the fork-tailed drongo's incredible mimicking abilities. It's one of the best mimics in the bush. And there's the famous story of the drongos in the Kalahari that have learned to imitate meerkat alarm calls. And they not only imitate them, but of course a meerkat has about 14, 15 different alarm calls. One that says, come here, there's a snake. Another that says, look out, there's an eagle about to take your head off. Those kinds of alarm calls. And they all mean different things. And some can just mean stand still, and others can mean dash for safety immediately. And fork-tailed drongo has worked out, or a couple of fork-tailed drongos in the Kalahari have worked out which call means what. And they imitate the one that means drop everything and run for cover. And they'll imitate that alarm call because, of course, a meerkat sentry never lies. And then they will take advantage of whatever food the meerkat have left behind. It's not a far stretch to imagine that a fork-tailed drongo has learned to do the same thing with a group of dwarf mongoose like these. I've never seen it in practice, but I suspect that it does occur. And maybe as we go into the drier months, as things get a little bit tough out here, and the fork-tailed drongo, being a non-migratory bird, will have to tough it out with the rest of the mammal species, perhaps we will get to see that kind of thing in action. That'd be incredible. Imagine if we got to witness that. Be one of the first people in the world to see an interaction like that. For now, though, the dwarf mongoose happily reliant on the true alarm calls of the fork-tailed drongo. That is, of course, when they decide to leave the safety of home and comfort. And I don't blame them, quite frankly, because it really is very chilly this morning. If I had a nice warm termite mound to hide in, I might also be reluctant to leave. I've spent a lot of time with dwarf mongoose over the last few drives, and they're always enjoyable, they're always up to something different. And their balance is also always impressive, and one perching on the top of the termite mound. We're going to leave our dwarf mongoose family to go about their morning business. In the meantime, Steph has found some interesting, very small insects behaving interestingly.
Have a look at this very unusual sighting that we've got of some polyrhynchus ants busy tending to their flock of aphids. Obviously, over the last couple of days, I don't know this tree, I haven't seen it, but over the last couple of days, a small family of aphid have moved into this tree and have now been found by a colony of polyrhynchus ant. And one ant, one worker would have found, or forager would have found this colony, would have milked some honeydew from them, gone back to his nest and called all his friends. And now we've got all the worker polyrhynchus ant that have come onto this tree and are busy tending to these aphids. And basically what they're doing is the aphids live on tree sap. The tree sap is very low in nutrition. And so what happens is the aphid has to suck up quite a lot of tree sap to get the nutrients that it needs. It then exudes honeydew almost on request from the ants. The ants will tickle it. You can see there how the ants are using their antennae to stroke the aphid, who will produce a drop of honeydew, which the ant will then suck up. Have a look at that. And then use for their own nourishment. Now, the aphids benefit because the ants protect the aphids. The ants benefit because the aphid provides basically a form of sustenance for it. But it's very, very rare to come across something like this in this area. I've only seen it literally once or twice in my whole guiding career. These polyrhynchus ants, they're actually fantastic animals. One of the more primitive of the ants, quite slow moving, live in colonies with a thatched entrance. Won't be too far away from where we're standing at the moment. Probably at the base of one of these trees is this colony. They would have sent out, they forage singularly. So one worker would have left the colony and would have gone in search of some food and bumped into this. There we go. You see how the ants had that very big reaction. So there you go. You got a prime example of how they protect their aphid flock. The tree was bumped, and all of a sudden they went from tending mode to attack mode. You can see that ant just getting ready. Now, back to the aphid, tickling that aphid with their antennae. Ant is still a bit wary. There we go. Those aphids have got their own camouflage. They almost look like little mini thorns. And quite a lot of ants. This is about as big as what the polyrhynchus ant colony gets. About 50 to sort of 70, 80 individuals. But while these ants are going nowhere with their little aphid flock, the tiny little elephant that Brent is with will go across and have a look at him.
Look at this. And they've moved out into the open, so we went and checked the boundary quickly, nothing there. The eddies have come out of the thickets, and we're busy being stalked by what looks to be a little boy. And I love it when they do this. They sort of pretend they're not. He's definitely watching us, and he's trying to give us a smell. But I think he's going to wait for the females to get a bit closer. Vim, should we put the VR on? Oh, look at that, like a gunshot. Branch breaking. So you're going to hear a few little beep, 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 beeps. So I'm just going to put the virtual reality rig on because I think these Ellie's going to come really close to the car.
Only picking up 6 cams.
Oh dear.
Having trouble with one.
That seems like the virtual reality one's not really working, so don't worry about what I said about the beeps. There must be, just from where I'm sitting, I can see probably 30, 35 elephant, and I can hear a lot more around. Here comes a big cow. And another cow coming off to the left. We're about to be enveloped. Hello, madam. Oh, she's got a big rip in her right hand here. There we go. Hello, little. We're still being stalked. There's just elephants everywhere. Hello, you two. Some sort of injury on the trunk there. Yes. Hello, little one. Yes, you're very scary. We were shivering in our boots. Isn't that wonderful? Here comes another big female. I don't want to move the vehicle just yet while they're walking towards us. Absolutely magical. Hello, madam. Hello, big lady. So I'm just talking very quietly. The elephants are very close to us. She is literally about 3 feet from the left-hand side of our vehicle. And see, she stopped to have a snack. Almost zero interest. Actually, zero interest in us. Hey, big girl. So special. So I'm just going to let her walk off a little bit, and then I'm going to move down onto the road where all the babies went. Let's see how far she is. Let's give her a little bit more space. And now, letting the car run here is even more important, just because there's so many females and babies around. Any two sudden movements or that brrr and then immediate movement might cause a negative reaction. If you just go slowly, that should be 100% fine. Hello, little boy. What? No head shake? No trumpet? There's a half-hearted little trumpet. That sounded like from one of the little guys. Ah, there they are. Little gang. Three of them. And they're playing with each other through there. And that's where the little trumpet came from. Oh, Vim. We're being attacked. Another little boy coming through, shaking his head at us. And we go around the bush, attack us from around the bush. Yes. Interesting behavior going on there. Let's go up there. Looks like some... Oh, yes, to you too. Oh, elephants everywhere. We've got traffic jam. I'm trying to get to where there's two elephant bulls fighting. Young bulls. You just see them creating a huge amount of dust. And rushing into each other. I mean, just look at this. There's just elephants everywhere. Hello, Naughty. See, between these two, there's just this dust storm, and then those two young bulls at the back chasing each other, and you can see the remnants of the dust. Those two, they're the ones who look like they were causing lots of nonsense with each other, so that's why we rushed over here quickly. This is, when they do start this playing, it's really, really fun. Move forward a little bit now that the others have passed us. Oh dear. There we go. There's more elephants coming down the road. They're just literally elephants everywhere. Put ourselves in the best spot where we can see as many. Oh no, that's just too nice to miss. Oh, and there's fighting next to us. It's all going on here. It's just, I love the sort of elephant parade when they walk in a group like this and they're coming straight towards us. So we're just gonna switch off and stay right here. Look at the little guy in the middle. We'll find a nice snack on the way. It's literally everywhere. We don't know where to look. Now these two are at it again. Look at this. This is just incredible. Absolutely magic. Now we're going to have to keep very still now, as the herd passes on both sides of us. It's so amazing. Hey guys. Isn't this just the best? Oh. Wow. Oh, there's just something incredible about being able to sit there and be listen to them surrounded by elephants. Let's get a view of them. We're coming towards the end of the sunset, sunrise safari, but what a spectacular ending it's been. I mean, there must be close on 100 elephants in this area, and they're just, oh, just so, so special. There we go. I'm going to watch their bums move as we end off the show. So from Steph, Jamie, myself and Sam, hopefully Sam will be feeling a bit better soon. But I think it's going to be Jamie and I on the sunset safari. But for the last few seconds, let's look at these great grey backsides disappear.